thank you, everybody. Thank you so much for coming in this evening. It's wonderful to see so many friends of not just Michael and Patty, but of the Architectural Association back this evening for what I know is going to be a lovely, lovely evening event here as part of the public program this autumn. We are here tonight as part of something that has been titled Celebrating 40 Years of Practice, which indeed will be the subject of Patty and Michael's presentation in just
There's
a moment.
A wonderful song, 40 years on, something in a Sunday.
Well, that's what we can do is invent the title for this.
Voting,
40 years on, as they did many years ago, have come in together on the same evening. I'm told, although this might be folklore within the association, that Patty and Michael arrived on the very same day once when they came here to begin their studies many years ago, and it's wonderful to have them back here together. Within a very few years after graduating from the Architectural Association, of course, they set up the office that you all know and that will be the subject of this evening's event, and less than 20 years after that 1976 founding of the office, of course, were awarded jointly the RIBA Gold Medal in achievements noted in a citation provided by the RIBA at the time, which I do have to just read out briefly because you're going to love the language of this. But it said, for the use of innovative materials and construction techniques, energy efficiency, and the combining of the contemporary and traditional.
Right.
Good to know that we've confirmed that they got it right. I do think it's an incredibly understated way to try and describe what Michael and Patty and all of their many collaborators have accomplished over the years. I think, in fact, it doesn't go nearly far enough in explaining the ways in which the ingenuity, intelligence, creativity, and indeed, strangely in some of the projects, a kind of charisma has come out of projects that are at the absolute forefront from the very beginning of the practice of this question of how the modern and traditional might come together in architecture. That is a topic that you could say has driven their career and thinking from its very outset, and is demonstrated in any number of projects that the practice has accomplished over the 40 years that it's been in existence. Indeed, I think you could say that the resolution of contrasts, opportunities, contradictions in what is considered traditional in this country or modern is one of the distinctly British forms of expertise in the world. And for that reason, and the ways in which it sits at the very core of the practice's interests, you could say our two guests tonight are the absolute innovators and leaders of that kind of a project and have been literally from their very beginning. Indeed, almost the eccentric qualities of ways in which those two features in an architectural project come together today is another incredible discovery over and over again in some of the buildings that they have realized. I think you all know these projects. I'm not going to say anything about them in any great detail. I think the important thing is to realize that the delivery or the contemplation of what constitutes tradition or history in a discipline like architecture, or indeed in a nation like this one, is one of the great driving forces in what we think of as the modern world itself. If you want an example of how that sat in the center of their thinking from the very beginning of their work as they left this building, I would point to simply two examples, which would be the two remarkable houses that they begin their architectural lives and careers thinking through, one of which happens to be a 400-year-old house in Sussex, I believe it is,
Suffolk,
which happened to be the subject of Patty's measure drawing course at the Architectural Association many years ago, and through that, decided it was a place to live and think.
She's giving the lecture, not you.
And a few years after that, to provide a stunning contrast, a house that you all know in this room incredibly well, that sits 40 years back now instead of 400, but which brings together the two absolute extremes of what one might think of as history and modern architecture. It's been said in a cliche that the sign of intelligence is the ability to carry two contrasting ideas within one's mind at the very same time, and for that reason, it's a pleasure to welcome the two smartest architects in the world, Patty and Michael Hopkins. Bring this back down.
I'm certainly not sure about that, but I'm going to
talk briefly. I'm a bit worried this evening because we've got masses and masses of slides. I've had trouble keeping Michael. He wants to show you everything. We've done a lot of buildings in the 40 years. Anyway, I'm going to just talk very quickly about what it was like here in the beginning. And you see Michael there in the middle. And what are they all doing? They're all smoking. That's extraordinary. That was his year. But so our story began here in the early 60s when we met as students from different paths. Michael is a mature student in his 20s who had started at Bournemouth Art Architecture School and then come to London to work in practices. He seemed very cool, as you can see. I came straight from school, very unformed and uninformed, but ready for life. It was a good time to be a student at the beginning of the swinging 60s, exemplified by new stylish clothes and music. Change was in the air. London was emerging from post-war gloom. In fact, many of our tutors here had fought in the Second World War. We were the inheritors of their ambitions for the large-scale rebuilding of bomb-damaged cities that were being zealously cleared away to make way for a brave new world. Our preoccupations were closer to urban planning than to architecture, focused through annual programs, first-year studio, second-year village, third-year town, fourth-year cities, fifth-year thesis. Projects were preceded by contextual studies on the surrounding fabric, social framework and movement patterns. Design effort went into development of sections and plans to encourage new patterns of living. We were obsessed by the effect of the car on life. In my third year project, I put a complete pedestrian traffic segregation system into my proposal for the improvement of a small Kent town. We had no real thought or interest in materiality or how our designs would be structured, in spite of the weekly structures lecture. It didn't really apply to our projects. Inspired by images of Alto Scandinavia in the US, we wanted a fresh wind to blow through grey old England. Students went on to work for local authority architects departments who were building these ideals. Michael's school portfolio was completely destroyed by a North London flood, as was most of mine, but this is the plan of my thesis project, a community care unit to be built using the American SCSD system, developed for school and construction in California. Norman Foster was on my jury. He liked the scheme and frankly saved the day. And this was our first meeting with Norman. Soon afterwards, Michael took a potential job into his practice and then went into partnership with Norman and Wendy. But going back a bit, my mother came up to London and took us out to dinner and decided that it was time that we got married as I was planning to move into Michael's flat. That's how it was in those days. So we got married in 1962. I soon discovered that Michael had other plans. He used to get the Society for the Protection of Ancient Buildings' regular list of properties in need of restoration. One had caught his eye in what was then deepest Suffolk. The townhouse was a dilapidated building next to the church, built in 1547 as a poorhouse with meeting rooms for the parish, following the passing of an act forbidding holy day festivities from taking place in churches. So we started clearing this house on our honeymoon. My mother thought we were doing a bit of painting. This was our first project together. We discovered...
Those are the neighbours.
Yes, that chap there was actually living in the ground floor when we were upstairs. This is our neighbour. We discovered that what seemed like a crumbling romantic ruin was actually a highly organized system of construction and services with a clearly engineered timber frame and an articulate plan underlying it. Central chimney stack, heated rooms either side, unheated rooms at the end, and probably unheated up at the top. And we looked at the mortise and tenon joints. You could tell exactly how the house was originally built. And this is the drawing Brett referred to that I did for my working drawing. What was it?
Measured drawing.
So that was our family holiday home for a long time. then we lived with our young family at the time in a small housing association, Winscombe Street, designed by Neve Brown, which has just been listed, as have all Neve's other buildings. And Neve was my tutor here, actually, at one time, so it was a sort of link. I ran a small practice from home. That was our... Whoops, sorry, I'm not very good at them. Sorry. That was our house at the end there, and I ran a little practice there in between other things. But in between...
Two of the other things.
them. things were getting a bit tight. So by the mid-70s, we thought, you know, we'll look for something. We'll think about expanding. And it was a strange time in the mid-70s. It was one of those crashes that have happened periodically during one's life. And this was to our advantage because Benham and Reeves in Hampstead had 12 sites on their list, you know, a completely unheard of situation now. Anyway, we found this site. The buildings were demolished when we bought it, but there had been a studio at this level, the garden level, and a garage above, joined to that house there, which had been lived in by Frederick Gibbard, who both Michael and I had worked for, so it was another sort of link. But we inherited it with the division
we
here.
We paid for it.
We took it over. And it was our opportunity to build a sort of spacious, well, comparatively, just detached, a meter from either side, frame house, not timber this time, but a steel frame house, like the Californian houses, the Eames house, although it was very different, but the California houses that we so admired. And we just got, there was a sort of a building control issue front and back, and we got in this 12 meter by 10 building, which was prefabricated off-site on Canby Island, came and was welded up on-site by the chap you see up there. No health and safety in those days. So there were foundation pits, frame, profile steel, which arrived on-site to the right length, placed on the floor and the roof and the sides. And there's Michael looking hopefully into his garden. And that's the finished house, where we still live and which we've enjoyed a lot. Glazed garden and street side, and sort of contained by Venetian blinds. And that's sort of garden view with the lights on at night. And this was actually where the practice started. We actually moved the office into this upper space with a sort of shed for a lavatory before we actually moved in down below. So the idea, it hadn't been the idea, but we then decided, okay, we've got this sort of showcase anyway, and Michael had a job from Willis Faber, which we started doing here, and then the practice sort of began. And I'm going to hold on.
We couldn't go back a few. I wanted to go back half a dozen.
We haven't got time for
that. Yes, we have. I just want to go back to that.
What?
No, one more. That one. No, what? One more.
Okay.
That one. One of the advantages I was remembering the other day about doing a light frame like this and putting the deck in is that, you know, we'd sold our house, the Neve Brown house, and we'd blown the entire sum on this plot, and then just started off building. And then doing this sort of frame construction meant that, you know, you could use it at any stage. You could start living there. In fact, there is a slide, which I don't know if you've got in here, on the floor below, where we bought a wooden garden shed, which we stuck over the ground floor drainage, and on the inside of it was a loo and a wash basin, and on the outside of it was a kitchen sink, and you could you know, you knew that you could colonize this space, you know, even if you didn't have enough money to finish it off.
Now you can go. But we did finish it.
We did.
It did.
What was that, madam? It's still there, isn't it?
Okay, coming on.
I've got to do some now.
Now, yes, how did we get this job, Green King? Before this, I was in partnership with Norman Foster for 3 or 4 years, and we'd just finished the Willis Faber building at Ipswich. And Willis Faber had set me up on my own, doing work for them in Ipswich, and also the converting the Port of London Authority building into their head office in London. So we had work. And then this job came along out of the blue, was to design a draft beer department for Green King in Bury St Edmunds, Green King being brewers. And I think I got the job because they knew that I'd got the Willis Faber building built in Ipswich, and that, you know, we were Suffolk folk, and I knew the difference between one Suffolk beer and another. So I went for an interview that morning, came up from London, and stayed the night in a hotel in order to be there on time, and I borrowed my sister's car to come up to Bury St Edmunds from London, and I'd forgotten my luggage, so I travelled up in jeans and a sort of sweatshirt, and had nothing to go to the interview in, so I went into a gents outfitters in Bury St Edmunds, and I bought a pair of cavalry twill trousers and a doggy sports jacket and one of those shirts with sort of crisscrosses on them, and a sports jacket. I spent a fortune on this outfit, and went to the interview, and everybody around the boardroom table had exactly the same. So, you know, I waltzed into this job.
Okay, go on.
Have I got to go on? So what we did was we started off. We designed a building. It has two faces to it, front and back. One, you unload the beer barrels and start washing them. And at this end, the other end, you in the middle, you fill them all up again. And at this end, you take them off.
I think I should. As described, as
in that diagram, yeah. and it very much sort of followed on. It was an industrial version of our house, which, you know, whereas our house was stemmed from this sort of architecture anyway. Next one, and the details and things were sort of getting the bits and pieces right, with a very supportive client. One very lucky thing, the site was flooded, so you had to lift the whole building off the ground by about a metre and a quarter, which, of course, you know, gave the building an enormous sort of start in life. Okay, next one.
And it was the tailgate height for a lorry. So it was rather fortunate.
Everybody was happy with that. Now, quite
I don't know why he's got this in.
I'll tell you why I've got this in. I'll tell you why we've got this in. We were interviewed, and we didn't have to do competitions. You got interviewed, and we were interviewed. We were put on a list by Terence Conran, who was a trustee at the V&A, to do a master plan for the V&A. And I put this in here because it's the first time we worked with an old, well, first time in our practice we worked with an old building, or might work with an old building. And Terence had put us on this list purely, and I took to the interview, we went to the interview together, and took our only piece of work, which was our steel and glass house, which Terence had liked and had seen, and why he'd put us on this list. And all the other trustees wondered what on earth we were doing there. with our steel and glass house. But who was the director at that most?
Roy Strong.
Roy Strong was the director who fuffed and foofed all the way through our interview and thought this was ridiculous. Apparently, after we'd gone, said, "Well, he's the architect for me," and we got the job. And really, and we did a master plan which you've just seen, and we did the index gallery, which was opening it all. It had been filled during the wartime. It had been and years after the war, all these things these buildings were lined out with plasterboard because it became unfashionable to have in museums to actually show objects like this against a Victorian interior. But we opened it all up again and started with the index gallery, and we did one other one as well. Unless you take the slide out. Yeah, the Raphael cartoon court.
The main thing we did at the V&A was actually take up all the black linoleum.
Yes.
And exposing this amazing, rather simple, nice mosaic.
Next one.
Okay, I'm going to talk quickly about Patera. This is our client was a Stoke-on-Trent steel stockholder. I don't know how we got hold of him, or he got hold of us.
It is your hometown.
I know, but I didn't think it was anything to do with that. But he wanted, they had all this steel, and this young grandson of the chairman, who had trained as an architect, thought that it would be interesting to develop a building system, which we were really keen to do because it tied up with a lot of our preoccupations or our interests. So you can see the components of the system, the trusses that bolt together, the panels are made up, insulated panels, and they all go together. They could go together by forklift truck like this. These are two going up in Stoke-on-Trent. And we sold, some were sold to, we actually took over the factory after a bit because they,
you did.
I did, because they'd become disenchanted with it actually. But we sold a couple to Docklands, here they are. And this was Docklands, they'd put in the infrastructure, but they hadn't built any buildings. It was rather an amazing place. And they put these two little buildings there, which I think were sort of information centres.
One was the BBC and one was sort of information office.
I think so, yeah. Anyway, we used these are our office buildings. This is the first one is an adaptation where we made got another floor in to get a mezzanine in, and that building back there, the back one, is the original one, and here is. How the office used. Oh no, there aren't so many drawing boards. There's some drawing board. And Robin, do you see yourself there?
No, that's not Robin. That's Jim.
Oh, it's Jim.
Robin had all his hair in those days.
Sorry, I thought it was a lucky coincidence that we had you in the photograph. After that, we put in another mezzanine, and it's actually a really nice place to work. Okay, Michael.
Oh, now, that's only in there. This job never happened. But we were, because of our Green King building, it had caught the eye, and was an industrial building, and it had won lots of awards, and it had been published quite a lot. There wasn't a great deal else to publish, perhaps, at the time. And it was seen by the development architect, the senior architect at Basildon Development Corporation. And he had, in those days, Basildon was a rather old-fashioned new town, or rather with a supposedly old-fashioned shopping centre. It had a nice open square in the middle. And the shopping centres were becoming enclosed and roofed over, and that... This Basildon were worried about that, and we got commissioned to roof over the town square, and it was interesting to think about, because what was suggested to us, maybe we might do this in some form of tented structure, and at the time it was about these structures were just being built, these tented membranes. I mean, that back one, this is the Hajj terminal at Mecca, with these extraordinary membrane roofs over. I mean, you can see these are jumbo jets parked alongside this huge building, so you get an idea of the scale of the building. And the next slide, so the purpose of the building was to provide shade. For the Hajj pilgrimage at Mecca. So this inspired us to do this enclosure, and we spent 4 years, and we'd had other jobs to do as well. We spent 4 years working on this project with an engineer called Michael Dixon, who was one of the partners, a senior partner in Bureau Happold. And they never got built. Next slide. It never got. We really developed it, and we were paid for it. You know, it was a really important thing in our practice. But nothing's ever actually wasted in the end, because that was seen and known about, and we were Bernard Vive, the managing director of Schlumberger. Schlumberger are a French oil exploration company, and we were invited to do a building for them on the outskirts of Cambridge, I think partly on the strength of something that never really got built, but we knew all about it. We knew how to do these things by then, and we built this. It was probably our first, no, it was after Green King. Where the very, very simple concept, where you had a slab, which ground floor slab, which is the floor of the building, and you then put all these drill pits into it for testing various bits of equipment, either below ground because they were dangerous, like the one on the right, or being able to lure a drill stick into it. And then either side of the test station, we put the scientists' studies, so that on the outside they had windows out into the countryside, and then into the middle they could see into the test station, which was the whole purpose of this building. How do you make it go forward? So there, very simple plan, test station in the middle, studies all along the outside with views out into the fields, and you could come to the office in the morning, and you could either come in the front door, which was that end, or you could come in, you could park your bike outside and come in through the French window of your office. And then you had these control laboratories, and then the business end of the whole thing in the the business end in the middle. It's a very simple diagram built with these membrane roofs, because all you needed to do with this test equipment, that's the point of it, was that you needed to keep the rainwater off it so that the scientists could go in and take readings, because it was all equipment that was really normally outside in the desert or in an oil field somewhere. And you had two of the three bays at the workshop in, with these giant pieces of equipment and a travelling crane above. And then they said, okay, let's build a third bay and make that the sort of social hub of the building, which we did. So we built a third bay onto it. On the left-hand side, you've got a great glass wall, soundproof glass wall, with very noisy equipment, but three layers of glass that you could see the whole operation going on. And then this became, there was some, you could eat at the far end, some magazines and things here, meetings in here, and visitors came in here and had their meetings. See what happened. Is it the middle one?
No, it's the side.
Oh, yeah. So that was it at night. And then two or three years later, they came back and said, build us an extension. In the 3 years from all this experimental stuff here going on with equipment, research in the oil industry had gone onto the computer, and we doubled the amount of work they were doing in here, in this little building, which we stuck on the front there. They still used their studies and things, and they were still doing some stuff so this became the sort of new end that we stuck on, and became the new entrance to the building. So that was our first membrane scheme. Then another unlikely scheme, really, for us. It's a lot of our work has come through other architects, sort of in certain positions, sort of knowing. There was a chap who used to, was an architect who was on the States Committee at Lords and knew about our work at Cambridge. Wasn't a very ambitious architect himself. I mean, he was much more actually interested in cricket, which is why he was on the States Committee at Lords. And he put our name forward for it. I mean, I had absolutely no interest in cricket at all. I mean, I'd loathed it at school. But it was just up the road from our office. And we won a sort of limited competition. With me feigning interest in cricket, but very much inspired by the pavilion. I've never been into Lords before, but inspired by the pavilion on the right there, which was built as an Edwardian building. But it's a real English summer building. You know, it was built out of built in brick and faced in terracotta. And dressed in white, you know, all its sort of trimmings were white, and then the roof was the upper tier was raised so you could see the sky underneath the roof, and it was this quintessentially English summer. So when we were going to build the mound stand next door to it, had this idea of I'll go on a slide. The stand that we were going to replace was this, the old mound stand. The pavilion over there, designed by an architect called Verity, a smashing building. And then typical Lords, typical MCC, they started on the next building, which was also done by... also done by Verity, was the mound stand here. And he got off to a fine start here. You see, he'd done all his colonnading and stuff here. And then they ran out of money and propped the rest of the stand up on the outside. They built a wall round so that people who shouldn't get in couldn't get in. It's this great high brick wall. And then they propped the rest of the stand off the outside wall. And they'd been like that probably for 30 years. And then they'd asked us to renew it, and we had this idea of taking the windows out, and then taking their outside wall off. That was the best, opening up the whole ground to the street, make a piece of street architecture out of it, and continue that bit's just here on the on the right of this slide. Build crib, because I didn't know how to... Well, I knew a little bit about brickwork, but certainly nobody else in the office knew anything about brickwork. Mackay Building Construction. We didn't do much building construction here, but I knew a little bit about it, and cribbed the Victorian brickwork, load-bearing masonry, and then... We repaired the existing seating. We repaired the existing seating, renewed it, recalibrated the terraces, and then put this piece on above in a modern construction. And perhaps it was the first. Brett refers. It was the first. So we sort of combined two bits of bits of architecture together by happenstance, really, not through any sort of particular belief. Next slide, yes. Yeah, and there, you know, Lords would be a popular place, whatever we did. But anyway, the stand has been successful, and it's a very nice place to watch cricket on a summer day under the membrane roof, where of course we learnt the technology at Schlumberger how to do these things. Next slide. This one. We'd been involved at the V&A, that helped, and we'd been involved in Lords. We were working for the establishment in a way. You know, we weren't people who frightened the establishment. We were people who did nice things for the establishment, like the V&A and like Lords Cricket Ground. So somehow we got on the list to rebuild this building here, the old Financial Times building, absolutely hideous building, designed by Albert Richardson in the 50s. And it was the first, Financial Times had just renewed their printing works. Nick Grimshaw had done a brand new plant for them in Docklands for their printing, and they wanted to renew this building as offices for themselves.
The printing that used to take place in the centre.
Yes, that's right. This building was all about offices there and printing in the middle. And we were just about to pull it. We won a competition. That's right. That's how we won a competition to put a new building on the site, and a new building which had been approved by the planning authority. This building then got listed as the first post-war office building to be listed, because it was being built by this wretched chap who had been principal of the Bartlett at one time. Professor Sir Albert Richardson, and it really was a shocker. There were 27 different floor levels in it. Nothing lined through. The right-hand wing was not different from the left-hand wing, completely different designs. No geometry to it at all. Anyway, it got listed. We just won this competition, you know, really mega competition. So they went round London looking for an architect who might know the Queen, because they felt that might help. And they found Philip Dowson.
This is the Japanese owners.
They'd sold it in between the Financial Times owning it and everything going on. They'd sold it to the Japanese for £75 million, which was then and still is probably the largest sum of money ever paid for a site next in the City of London. And that's the most important bit of the story. And the bloody thing was listed. Because they'd bought our design for a new building for £75 million. And so they were running around London looking for an architect who might know the Queen. And they finished up with Philip Dowson, Sir Philip Dowson, who was a senior partner at Arup Associates, and did look very distinguished and look as though he might well know the Queen. and he rang me up one day and said, Michael, you know, we worked together on the Royal Fine Art Commission. He rang me up one day and said, you know, Michael, your client's looking for an architect for, you know, to take the scheme on. I said, oh, God, it's our best project. Could you be a consultant? And he said, you know, I design buildings. You know. Anyway, Philip agreed to be consultant. Philip was about my age now, and took all the flack off, and particularly my shoulders, and negotiated our fee for us, and took the Lucy Reed china to pottery, to Lucy Reed bringing pottery to Japan as a sort of gifts and that sort of thing. He took all that side of things, left us to get on with the design of how to convert this building into... am I going on too long?
Whereabouts is it in the...
It's just south, immediately south of St Paul's. I didn't show you the left-hand slide.
Where is it? I've lost it.
I'll find it.
Where is it?
So there it is there. There's St Paul's over to the right. It's very, it's okay. Hot, it has a sort of...
So what we did...
It passed the support. And what, so what we did was... Who did that drawing? It was a brilliant drawing. Somebody in the office did that drawing.
Bill Taylor, I think.
No, it wasn't Bill.
Bill Dunster, sorry.
Bill Dunster, that's right. Mm-hmm. We took the printing works out of the middle. Just been listed, this building. First one in London to be listed after the war. Office building. And put a new middle in the middle and kept the two outside wings and brought the entrance from this opposite St Paul's round to the middle of the building where the lorries are at the minute. And that's what we did. Everybody was very happy with that outcome because it worked. We actually got more square footage on the site than we had with our new building, so that made the property people very happy because it was the most valuable site in the city. And it was an expensive building. It was a building made out of load-bearing stone and bronze on the structural bronze on the outside with a frame, and it fitted well back into the fabric of the city. Now, this going through the office at the same time, that one came first, and then this one came, and two of the board members, one in particular. One of the board members on the FT and Pearson's, who was the holding company for the FT, Michael Blakenham, was chairman of MEPC, who was a property development company, who undertook the development of this site for IBM. IBM wanted new London headquarters and bought a huge site out London, just the gravel pits near London, south side of London Airport. And they took their site to MEPC and got them to organise the development for them because they didn't trust themselves not to spend too much money on it. They wanted to restrict themselves to the rigours of the current marketplace. Anyway, so IBM proposed us, because I'd worked for them, I'd done a building for them when I was with Norman, and they proposed that we should do the building, and because MEPC's chairman was on the FT board, they were quite happy with us doing this very large piece of development, which followed soon. They were going through the office at the same time. Can I go back one? What I wanted to do was, around about this time, if you built in the countryside, even if you were building offices, you did sort of fragmented layouts, but sort of linked together by roads and car parks. That was a standard way of doing things. But I was interested in doing a piece of city in the countryside, and I was much encouraged by this Grosvenor Square in the 1700s, where they just built out. You know, in the background you see the twin hills of Hampstead and Highgate, and they just built a bloody great. This is Oxford Street running along in the foreground here, and they just built an extension outwards into the countryside, and they built it like another bit of city. So I felt, well, if they could do it, it was all right for me to do the same sort of thing. So that's what we did. We built a new piece for IBM. And we did the master plan, and this end we did these three new buildings for IBM, and at this end, Ted Cullinan did the other end. And the thing that we were both up, I remember now, we were both up for this master plan, Ted and I. And Ted was on holiday when they had to make a decision. So I said, well, why don't we just get on with it and see whether we get on all right? I said, all right. They said, all right. And we did this end. We did the buildings for IBM. And then Ted did some this end, which were quite different, but on to our master plan. And were the ones that they were going to sell off. And this was an exercise in steel frame construction, this is the actual frame expressed on the site. Without fire protecting it, it was very carefully fire engineered, the amount of openings and things in it, so we didn't have to wrap up the steel frame in concrete to protect the, which is the main story about this whole building, which I won't go into. And the main building had this sort of interior. And a year or two later, we were sitting in the cinema one day, and in a James Bond movie, the one where it's a lady climbs up, or a Japanese lady climbs up a wall, which she's got metal boots on, or magnetic boots on, and she climbs up this wall with her feet on the outside. We suddenly realise they're making a movie in our building, and it finishes up with her running across here, followed on by James Bond, and they go disappear through a door on the right, and they appear in Nick Grimshaw's
printing works. I think it's real fame.
Nick's never seen that film. quite different. You talk about this.
Can I? Okay. This is
another trustee at the
V&A who became great friends, David Meller, the cutler, bought this site outside Sheffield in Hathersage. This was I don't think it was like this actually when he bought it. But this is what had been on the site. It was a little gasworks for the little town gasworks, but he wanted a cutlery factory, and we went up one weekend, and Michael saw this circular.
He demolished the.
I think it was demolished.
Yeah, it was demolished.
Michael said, "Well, why don't we build you a round building?" You know, and David said, "Well, yeah, I suppose cutlery can be made in a round building," so that's what we did, and David was a great. He liked building for himself. He liked making things, not just beautiful bits of silver or stainless steel, but he liked the building process, and he got his own team. You can see they used the base, the circular base, and developed that. It was in the Peak National Park. Stone was going to be popular, so we built the circular stone building with entrances each quarter, framed in precast concrete, I think. Mm. Then a sort of bicycle wheel. Whoops. Sorry.
David really wanted to do a stone building, and we wanted to do a metal one.
Yeah.
And that was the compromise between
us. So he built himself, or had built this bicycle frame, which is sort of nicely detached from its circular base, covered in lead panels, which he developed, insulated lead panels, I assume.
Yeah.
I think. Ventilation at the top, and then
a few years later
we inserted this little cafe museum. It's a museum. I think it was Was it built after David died? I think it was. It was a sort of slightly in memory of him.
It was a sort of memorial thing, built by his son.
You can see where it is sort of opposite that, and that's rather a nice little insertion. And also we did for him what was going to be their sort of London headquarters. It is in Shad Thames in Docklands. And this is a concrete frame building clad in or within the frame lead panels. It's rather nice, actually. And that's the circulation stair. Unfortunately, he built at the wrong time and they had to abandon it, and Terence Conran bought it. And Terence, they were going to live on top here. There's rather a nice pad we did for them up there. Shop below and then sort of offices in between. But they in the end, they abandoned that, and Terence lived up there for quite a long time. So I'll go on. Shall I go on with Glyndebourne? This is the Opera House at Glyndebourne, which is, for those who don't know, is a sort of family concern running a summer festival, summer opera festival. That's the old family house, sort of different ages. There used to be a smaller theatre attached to the organ room there, which is where they first started doing recitals. We sort of found it's quite a challenging site. It was sort of full of lots of bits of building. And our solution was to, and it's quite a big, you get these quite big volumes from the flight tower of the stage under the auditorium and the back and side stages. So I'll move on, sorry. So you can see here how those are the sort of elements of the building I talked about. We decided to wrap the people spaces around the outside, basically. Like Cambridge and like, what's the other one? Lords, really. We were quite keen on these curved spaces which sort of fitted into places. This has got the foyers front, three levels of foyers, or sort of circulation foyers, and then the main gathering one. And then towards the back, sort of beyond here, are the dressing rooms, workshops, wig department, that sort of thing. The main thing we did was actually turned the whole building around by 180 degrees in order to bury this bulk into that. There's a 3-meter drop between the land at the top of the site and the land down here, and we lost quite a lot of its impact that way. And we also brought the public down to the gardens this side, which is one of the points of the place. You go and you picnic, and then you picnic in the interval, and you enjoy the opera, picnic in the gardens. We developed our teacher and sort of mentor of this was Derek Sugden, the acoustic engineer from Arup Acoustics. He said you should really build in massive construction to help the acoustics, to stop sound in and out. So we did, and it was familiar really from Lords, but also we actually visited States and really enjoyed the Caen brick buildings fairly before this, sorry. And we decided this was an opera house in the countryside. It was not Covent Garden. It needed a sort of fairly rustic feel.
We had visited Caen's Exeter building, hadn't we? Yeah. Exeter Library, yeah. The summer before. Mm.
And we start with these are structural brick columns, no plaster, so that they had to be, they were fair faced all the way around. Concrete, precast concrete slabs and beams. It's simple, but it's a sort of effective. That's the canopy linking the building to the existing buildings, which we turned into, to the south, which we turned into bars and shops. Inside, we worked very closely with Derek, and this is a double, sorry, hopeless with it. This is a double skin brick drum. And you have to avoid centering of the sound in a horseshoe shape, which is what they wanted for intimacy. So every sort of inch of this brick drum is covered in panels, convex panels, to spread the sound, to enable a constant sound as far as possible throughout the auditorium, and also for sort of early bounce back from the singers and the musicians. And another, so that there was controlling the acoustic were the outside, the panels around the outside, but also the balcony fronts. They were all different. Derek used to describe them as different shaped busts. They were low slung, high, medium, to direct the sound around. And this is sort of
the worst thing you can do in an opera house is to design something where you can't help hear yourself sing. Apparently, that was the most important thing. Mm. You have to be able to hear yourself sing.
Where we go?
Not being a singer myself.
And that's there it is, sort of settling into the landscape there. Again, following on from David Mellor.
That was David's roof.
That was David's roof, really, yeah. Okay. I'll have a clicker.
You give me all the industrial bits.
Okay, Nottingham Castle. Whoops. Yeah. Nottingham Castle. Disused site between the canal and railway. A sort of transfer site. Abandoned.
Yeah, okay. Long abandoned.
Because
you only had the railway and the canal only were in use as a transport system for about less than 20 years before the canal system went out of use. I mean, that's right across the country.
I can't remember how many workplaces were here.
Hundreds.
Several thousand. Several hundred. And this was a competition which is workplace for tax inspectors moving out of town, and we put in a central public street and set up this site on axes looking towards the castle. Rather disappointing, a sheriff of Nottingham's castle, actually. It was rather sort of quiet.
If you come from Nottingham, it's a
brick town. These are sites nearby on the canal. And we built again in brick, but this time in precast concrete bricks. Precast bricks, pre-built bricks, really, built on off-site nearby, but off-site, undercover, arriving with a pin through them, lifted into place. Precast concrete slabs spanning across 13 metres, I think.
13 meters, yes.
Yes, on pads. And the thing went up incredibly quickly because there was no site delay. Those are the elevations, again, influenced by Khan, as you see. getting smaller towards the top because of less load. And there was a quite a forward, sophisticated ventilation system, natural ventilation system, because we were trying to get the buildings to work naturally.
This is a time when the offices had been getting very deep for a while, and we were asked to provide naturally ventilated offices with windows.
So these are accommodation stairs, covered in glass blocks, which heated up during the day and caused air. And as the air came up, these chaps lifted up on a sort of, what do you call it?
On the left, there's a little hydraulic ram.
Hydraulic ram, that's
at the top.
And that's one's lifted.
Temperature controlled, theoretically. the pump that lifted the roof up and down and controlled the rate of ventilation through the building.
There it is back on the canal.
Settled in.
And at night, a view at night along the street with the edge of the amenity building, sort of sports building that we built in the middle, which is very sort of sports and cafe, that sort of thing.
Back with our membranes.
And now we're in Cambridge.
Yes, I was going to talk about that one and you were going to talk about this one.
Do you want to talk about this?
No.
This is Emmanuel College in Cambridge, early days. Absolutely great Wren Chapel here. It's a very, very, really smashing site, which was not quite like this when we came there. Michael, the master at the time when we got the job was Norman St. John Stevens, who was chair of the Royal Fine Art Commission when Michael was on it, so he was a sort of friend, and he basically...
I was his favourite.
Yeah, when he became master, he decided that he wanted to make his mark on the college. They'd been talking about this site for ages, the dons there, but as usual, with colleges, they hadn't got anywhere. They needed Norman's
energy
and you know, ambition really to build a building. Anyway, this was a scruffy backyard with bins and car parking. And the site. They wanted a music school. They wanted some common rooms, music practice rooms, a performance space. So Michael actually came up with this really nice, again, familiar now by now, sort of lozenge, which detached from, you know, they've been thinking about sort of putting a wing on somewhere.
You've got rather a thing about round ends.
Actually,
they're quite useful because you can nudge buildings into spaces.
Mm.
And it also, the great thing about them is they save you having to design an end elevation. If you've worked out how to do the sort of side, you can sort of take it round the end. End elevations are much more difficult than side elevations. Mm. So if you can get your side elevation to go round the back.
So this is made of Ketton stone, like the Wren Chapel. It's a stone frame building, pre-stressed, I think it's called. So the frames are tied together.
It's
stainless steel, and with infill panels also. It has a sort of arcade around the base. This was exposed when we took sort of odd garages and things down. It was actually rather a nice. There was a sort of arcade, and then it went down and under the road to that building there, or that site over there, which was part of the college. So we opened that up, and this is a view through the arcade there. Inside, it's a small, I think it's 150 about seat, little performance space. It can be adjusted for different sounds, different for speech or music. There are blinds to block out the light, and there's a system of curtains that comes around here. I'm not sure how effective it is.
We did rather get into trouble from some lecturers because of all these windows.
Yeah, which we wanted. And then they're rather nice, at the other end, there are senior, middle, junior common rooms on each floor and practice rooms. And the other thing we did is we opened up the middle of the building. So as part of the sort of college progress, really, you come through the middle, and the entrance to the building is actually off to one side, inside the covered way. You insisted on putting this in.
Yeah, I'm not sure why. Well,
it's Christina.
Christina.
Hi, Christina.
Hi.
It's just
the For the Prince of Wales, we've always been the acceptable face of modernism. At least that was when he was younger. I haven't heard from him too much recently. But it wasn't through him. I don't know why we got this job. It was after Windsor Castle. It had this big fire, and the Queen needed to raise money to rebuild, because she took it upon herself to do so. She needed to increase her revenue flow in order to do the repairs to Windsor Castle. And so she opened, for the first time, she opened Buckingham Palace, or the royal family opened Buckingham Palace to visitors. It's still open now. Of course, they hadn't got a ticket office, and it was immensely popular, and they got people queuing all over the Mall. So we were asked to do, but we were asked by the Royal Collection, who ran the exhibitions and things inside, and the trips inside Buckingham Palace, to design a ticket office. So we did this tiny, it was a beautiful little building with a nice membrane roof on top. The membrane roof here had to just do its most, because it had a very nicely made timber cabin underneath, and then this just provide a bit of shelter all round for queuing, and primarily to sort of show them people where the ticket office was. That's the only slide of it.
Okay.
I was rather keen on it there. Should I talk about this?
I'll keep this.
What?
Up in Edinburgh.
Yeah. You want me to? Yeah. No, all right. Round about the same time, we were commissioned. I don't remember doing a competition for it, but we were. Oh, it was brewers. We were known in the brewing industry, which was quite good. This castle on the left wasn't a castle at all. It was a brewery. It had been built as a brewery inside this castellated structure here, early in the 19th century. Was it McCure's? No, who are the brewers?
Scottish, it's Alex Lott. Scottish and Newcastle.
Scottish, it was Younger's Brewery. I don't know how we got involved. But we did. And they demolished in order to make a car park. They built new brewery buildings this way towards me here. And inside the old brewery site, they'd used it as a car park for the brewery workers and the public. I suppose it must have been around millennium time. Maybe it was Edinburgh's Millennium Project.
Yeah.
That was it. So we came up with this idea of, and you can see in the section you had a basement underneath the thing for car parking. It's on, is it Cannon Row, Cannon Street? It runs. It's one street in from the from the peak and the crags at.
It was a big black box museum called Dynamic Earth, telling the story of the dynamic
oh, yeah.
Earth.
Because Edinburgh University had his thing about the natural development of the earth. Its purpose. You're not. Who's laughing?
Anyway,
I can't quite remember its purpose. There was a big exhibition inside this box,
and on top of the box, we put this.
The black box exhibition.
Yes, and then made this. Progression of
which gets used.
Yeah, that's it sitting there.
And it was Edinburgh's Millennium Project, so it was.
That's it, sort of sitting on top of the wall. It's actually slightly mucked up inside by...
That was done in 2000, it must have been, because it was for the millennium.
Yeah.
And it's really heavily used now. It's one of the main attractions in Edinburgh. Edinburgh itself being a sort of tourist attraction as a city.
It looks good there.
Up against Salisbury Crags.
Okay.
That's Parliament. That's the Portcullis House. inside we got this job by sort of some strange set of circumstances. I'm trying to remember the name of the architect who was, they often come through architects, these things, who was head of the PSA, Property Services Agency, and he was keen on our work. And he asked us to do a study. There was a big Victorian building on the corner there opposite Big Ben. Opposite Big Ben, and then just going further away up towards Parliament Square, they'd had to demolish a building because it was a dangerous structure, and that had been demolished for 10 or 15 years or something. It was just a great vacant slot. And there was another Victorian building. There were two Victorian buildings you can see here, and the one on the left was a really hideous thing. And we were asked to do a study of how to reuse these buildings. And being sly, I didn't try very hard on that. But I came up with a series of suggestions. We worked to a committee, the Accommodation and Works Committee of the House of Commons, run by a Welsh mining MP called Ray Powell, who was frequently cancelling our meetings because he used to go back to Swansea to change his pills. But he was a cunning old chap, and he used to call me Boyo. And we would have quiet little meetings with just him. So when he really wanted to get something across, we would just have a meeting with him, and then he would go and sell it to the committee. And we came up between us with the idea of building a new building on this site. Would be a much better thing to do. So that's what we did. We pulled down the listed Victorian building, our second listing success, and built a new building where the sort of prime job it had to do was to mediate between the Normanshaw Scotland Yard buildings on the right with all its chimneys and towers and turrets and the Palace of Westminster. I think everybody thought that somehow we would extend the Palace of Westminster across the road. That was sort of expected. But what we did in the end was we just picked up all the Normanshaw chimneys were primarily to do with fireplaces and things, but all the spikes and towers and turrets and things on the Palace of Westminster side, the House of Parliament side, they are all to do with ventilation systems inside the building. So we designed this ventilation system that worked with these great huge extracts running through the roof. And the thing that finally twisted it into a new building was the Jubilee line needed to pass through. They were building the Jubilee line at the tunnel, and the two running tunnels of the Jubilee line needed to go under, these are the two tunnels here, needed to pass through between our site and Big Ben. And they had to go through, so that they came along side by side, came down Victoria Street and crossed Parliament Square and then turned along the embankment. And as they came through our side, the tunnels had to go one above the other. So it had to go to Tulis. But what clinched it, the Jubilee line, if you build a new Jubilee line, you need an Act of Parliament for it. And Parliament was a bit iffy about this Jubilee line running through here. They were worried about Big Ben and all that. And in the our committee, who wanted to do our building, lent on their the other committee in Parliament to give the Jubilee Line permission to do the Jubilee Line in exchange for us being able to get permission to do and to take Mr. Key point as well, the Westminster Underground Station used to be at ground level and it used to sit right in the middle of this site. So we had the job of rebuilding the underground station and getting down to these two running tunnels and to build the building above. We had both buildings to do because that made sense. We had two different engineers because London Underground wouldn't give up their engineers, and we had Arabs working with us on the top deck. So we had to, and we'd finished up doing a scheme with what's known as top-down construction. We built this box underneath, and you can see the concrete walls at the side, but we started at ground floor level and then dug this box down from the top, building the structure down until you got to the bottom, running tunnel. And at the same time we did that, we were doing with a different firm of engineers, we were building up to support the parliamentary building. And this actually came, it was going on for quite a long time in the office, and it actually preceded that building I showed you in Nottingham for the Inland Revenue, where we built these precast, prefabricated brick piers. Here we built, and this came before the brick ones, we built prefabricated load-bearing stone piers, which got and of course, because we had this courtyard in the middle, there were offices on both sides facing into the courtyard and out onto the street. It wasn't a particularly deep building. It was about, I think it was 14, 15 metres deep. Naturally ventilated through the facade, and extracted through this plant in the roof, and in the middle we had a courtyard, so why not use the courtyard to make a place for, why not fill it in at the ground floor level, and make a place for. This wasn't in the original sort of program agreed, but we got it in. And it's now, I mean, it's really an incredibly popular space. It's a sort of social focus for the House of Commons, and much used by the House of Lords as well. And it sort of fits into London quite comfortably with its materials and its shape and form, both from the river and from Parliament Square. And then using this slide to cross over the river, with no. One or two buildings in between. Are you nearly there?
Where is it? I've lost it.
No, it wasn't there when this photograph was taken.
That would explain.
This site.
Okay.
We were asked to build a children. We won a competition. Damn it! To build a new children's wing. Called the Evelina Wing for Tommy's Hospital. I think because we were having success in building buildings in difficult and important sites, and what we no, stop it. We turned the building upside down. Took the main public floor up three floors, and we had all the consulting rooms and X-ray rooms and all that stuff were in a sort of the ground three floors plus a couple of basements, and then we had this big public floor at first floor level, and we put the wards behind it looking into this public space. If we,
looking into the.
See what the next slide is. That's on the ground. That's on the ground floor. Standard children's hospital stuff, and that. But the main sort of public space was here, and the wards were running up behind here. Fairly regular children's wards. looking out into this room and then looking upstream up the river, and this great floor in the middle here, where the great floor here in the middle, where parents could, worried parents could spend the day, or they were visiting their children who were in bed, and the kids could, those who could get up, could come down and hang out in this space with their ma and pa, and they could have tea. And it was run in a very, very family-friendly way. And of course, you had an excuse for sort of painting the lifts red and all that sort of thing. that's one of the wards overlooking the hospital. You do hurry on, darling.
Yeah, well, I'm aware of time. Okay, I think we've got quite a lot to do.
All right, round about the same time, here we are in Norwich. This is Norwich's, this is before the hospital. Norwich's Millennium Project, which was to rebuild the county archive and to extend it to make Norwich's Millennium Project. So this was about 2000. And we came, the county archive, which is best archive in the country, best county set of county records, going way, way back. The building had burnt down, but the whole archive had been in the basement, so the archive was saved, and it was insured, so they had insurance money to rebuild the building, and we won a competition to do it. And the sort of notion behind the competition was this. Norwich is full of churches. It's got something, I think it's 47 churches, and this is one of them, over and above the cathedrals. This is St. Peter Mancroft, which is a great church, a perpendicular church. And the library had been at the back of the, towards the back of the site here. That's and the library. Space in between the two was a city car park, which they used to get money charging for. So the city and county, who were normally daggers drawn with each other, came together to rebuild the county library with their insurance money, and the city gave up their car park to do their Millennium Project, and we pushed the two into one bit. So you had the back of the building, you had the library, and then in the front you had this sort of social space. We got one between.
It seems to have gone.
You must have taken it out.
Yeah,
those windows on those windows. this is the library. With those windows, you can see in the brick skin around the outside, a curved end, in order to fit into the town comfortably. Stop it.
No, it's not still in Norwich.
No, just go back one. Pat, give me
a minute. Where do you want to be? No, it's all right.
I'm not going to do a lecture with you again.
Come on. What did you want to say?
Well, the windows made these little sort of workstations between, and they're, it's very heavily used for people to work in the library. And then in the front of it, in the middle of it, you get this rather good space. We go there a lot now. Mm. No, you've jumped on.
No, I know. We're still in Norwich. And
shall I give up?
Very soon.
Is it time to go?
Michael always does this. He always has too many slides. And then I say, but it's going to take too long. He said, doesn't matter, I'll just stop.
No,
come on. I think we're going to whiz through some projects now.
Okay.
No?
Same what time, think, just after that, this other project in Norwich.
Okay. I'll start and you can butt in, okay? This is Norwich Cathedral. ruined cloister, buildings around the cloister. It's absolutely great cathedral.
Around the cloister, yeah. Lost in the refectory.
Yeah. This was the site of the refectory. And that is the rebuilding, it's the reusing of the...
They thought we won a competition because the sites that we were given were sort of out in the middle of the garden, and that seemed an awful waste. So we came up with this in the middle of the lawns on the west front. So we came up with this idea of rebuilding in the volumes that had been demolished, and we got, of course, lots of support from English Heritage to do it, to actually reuse these existing walls. And this one's the refectory back one.
You can see the windows we were seeing, the openings we were seeing on the wall before. And we put inside this box with its own structure within the existing walls.
Yeah. So there's no the roof loads didn't go down onto the walls.
Yeah. I think you did this, Eric, didn't you?
No, we did it.
No, but he I remember his. Sorry. Okay, so that's it. This is the first building, the refectory. And then we're now in Tottenham Court Road.
No, we're not. We're in.
No, we're not. We're in Euston Road. Sorry. We're in the Euston Road. The Wellcome Foundation, existing building. What was on this site before?
I don't remember.
I don't either. Anyway.
Must have been so. There was ragbag buildings.
Mm. Everyone will pass this often. It's linked to the old building, but it's absolutely jam-packed full of scientists and researchers. Isn't it?
It's where the Wellcome Trust gave away some huge sum of money distributed to medicine and sciences. I mean, it's tens of millions of pounds a year. Mm-hmm. And this building's really all about evaluating pieces of work that are put in front of them for funding. I mean, there's I can't remember how many, a couple of hundred people work in here. And it's all about evaluating schemes that are put to the Wellcome Trust.
There are two volumes of the building, this front one fronting the road, the taller one, and then there's a lower one at the back, which is sort of facing the university behind. And they're linked in the middle by this space, which links the two sides together with bridges. It's good space, and again, as usual, it's sort of a cafe meeting space. Now we're leaping up to Northumberland, to the Duchess of Northumberland's special garden, where we did this visitor centre.
The Duke gave her this walled garden to do something with, and she commissioned these French landscape architects to do this huge...
It's very incredibly popular venue. It's on the sort of coaches route, and They after she did it, she realised that she needed somewhere to sort of cope with all the visitors. And we put this little pavilion on the site of glass houses which had been along this enclosing wall at the back. And this is, as you come through the hole in the wall into the garden, this is the view. It's rather a sort of baroque garden which sort of grows on you. It's quite nice. It's quite nice now. And we put a canopy on, which is enclosed either side for two different sorts of restaurants. And now we're in the States. Just we're going to quickly show you what three buildings we did for universities in the States.
There's Yale, we got asked to... do the School of Environmental Studies. Patty and I had been, we'd been to Yale to look, I think, years before, and somebody from Yale visited our office, who was a link between the School of Architecture and the School of Forestry, and he was starting a new department, a School of Environmental Studies. And we, through him, we got asked to Yale to do this School of Environmental Studies. And the point of this photograph is that the our site, you know, when you first went to the site, you got this bloody great sort of imposing building on the corner, built in the 19th century, and you went through this arch, and you came into one of these sort of junkyards at the back, because they'd all the best sites at Yale and at many other places had gone in the night. All the corner sites, all the frontage sites had gone. So if you're working in an American university these days, you're building in the backyards. And that was this is the site that we were offered, you see, which is, you know, weren't grumbling about any off the site. But you can see the sort of gateway in with those brick pieces on the left there. And there was this sort of boiler house in the middle here. I think it was a boiler house or was it something else? Mm. We took that down and built this bar building, dividing this courtyard into two. But at the level change point, there were two levels in that courtyard, and using the bar building to deal with the change, and you entered it the far end, which is off the main street, and then what do they call this street? This hill with Philip Johnson's building at the top. Okay. The Science Hill, no, something like that.
Science Hill. Is it?
Say it again.
Science Hill.
Yeah, okay.
And this is the entrance end. The kids, just, you know, sitting on the wall, and that's the building that we built as a School of Environmental Studies, and it has this sort of interior with.
Circulate up the middle,
up a continuous. Thing always wanted to do, the building's the right length to get to put an entrance hall down at the bottom, and to take off at each floor level, and you finish up at the top stair at the top of the building. And because of that, we then got asked to Princeton, and we did the chemistry building. They're good. Good and interesting clients, American universities, and that's what we did, a two-piece building here. Laboratories on the left-hand side, and with connected with bridges across a public circulation space, with the researchers' studies. Literally, that's where they had a nice spot looking out over woodland. This is the space that ran up the middle between them. And this space was open to the university. And on the ground floor, we put educational laboratories so that it was on one of the main routes at Princeton. The kids passed through here. And they actually see some science going on, and maybe they'll get interested in science. And that was the opening party. And then one anymore, and that's you know, the usual nighttime picture. And one, that's that. The after that, this is us in the States. We got asked down to Rice, which. It's always been quite keen on English architects. I know Jim Sterling worked there, and somebody else between us, and we did two new. This is a view out of the sort of Hilton Hotel bedroom window where you're going to stay, and you look down and this you're in Texas now, Houston, and you see the sea, this green sea of live oaks, which are. Evergreen oaks, so they're green all year, and red roofs popping through them. That's the environment at Rice, which is great. And we did a couple of new colleges. They have a system like Oxford and Cambridge, i.e. you belong to a college and you work by department. And this was two new colleges, each with a dining room. and they needed to be slightly different, so distinguished between the two. And in the middle was a campus wide, i.e. for other colleges as well, sort of catering and cafe, and this is us doing our thing in Texas, you know, and it's a great extraordinary climate to work in, and this was the axis up. This is one of the dining rooms, and then on one more, you're going up here, and this is November in Rice.
Smells nice.
It's true, isn't it? I mean, it's just like the kids wear shorts all year round, and they have their supper out in the evening, and you probably spend tens of thousands of dollars to go there. Still abroad, because we'd worked in London for the Japanese, we got invited to. That was for Obayashi, who and the eventual redevelopment of the Financial Times building. We got asked this time by Mitsubishi, who owned the whole of the central business district, Marunouchi in Tokyo, to do their most important site, which is on the axis from the railway station, which is the traditional gateway to not only Tokyo, but really Japan. People arrived in Japan, they went to Tokyo, they went to the railway station. And on the axis, a bit like Buckingham Palace is on the axis of the Mall, it went up to the Imperial Palace. And we were on a corner of the square opposite the station leading up to the Imperial Palace, which is why they put the site up. It was a competition, actually. I think No, that's different.
Now we've jumped to Dubai.
All right.
We have an office in Dubai, and we've done some projects there. We're not going to talk in detail
the reason we have an office in Dubai is because we went to Dubai
for a lecture, one of these things
in Dubai.
You never know.
We took Abby's sister Sarah, who's not here, who was going to live in Dubai with her husband. They just got married, and we took her along with us, and she went to look at sort of where could they live, and we went to do a lecture, and they were going to be there three or four years, and then we got asked at the lecture or after the lecture to do. You know, we do look at something for somebody, and then that turned into a project. So we opened an office, and there have been 50. At the moment, we're white bang up to strength. I think there are 100 people there at the moment, and this is one of the earlier projects we did there.
This was an attempt not to do an enclosed shopping.
This time of year again.
That's it from the outside.
That's the outside of the shop. Yes.
So now we're back in England.
Oh yes, now I want to see. everything you've seen there, we were sort of primary, you know, we were the prime generators of this. And, you know, all our buildings are actually sort of worked in detail and are built by people who are now our partners, and these are there's a couple here which are recent buildings. Both of these are actually done by David Selby. The service, this was a public building again, Hackney. It's to do with the combining of the London boroughs. Hackney finished up with several boroughs under its wing, and opposite the town hall, built this. So they were prepared to do it sort of properly. Built this service centre where the public would go if you had a problem with the rates. your rent or you wanted, you know, you had some health problem, you would go to this building. So, and you see shades of our building in Norwich. It's a massive, great building built by a local authority in London a few years ago. And there's another one very nearby, which is Brent Civic Centre, which is built next door to Wembley Stadium. One's sort of standing on the, just immediately outside Wembley Stadium here, and this contains all the spaces for of a civic building. But these are not done by us. They're done by the current generation of partners. I didn't draw a line on this. But it's a very successful building of which I'm much proud. Then this one, which is the Velodrome, again was done by Mike Taylor in our office, who's been one of our partners for a number of years now, without anything to do with me at all. And the next slide, and that, you know, but it somehow contains the same genesis as some of our original buildings. That's it.
That's it. Sorry, everyone. Please go
questions.
If you have to. I know you do.
Aren't you going to ask a question, Abby?
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the presentation. And the story is about buildings. And I think if we have time to take a couple of questions, if that's all right with both of you.
It's all right, Abby, but I hate asking them.
Then I'll start for you. I'll ask a question. You touched on it a couple of times in the talk, but I think one of the remarkable things in terms of the continuity that spans across the projects is that it undoubtedly has also been the part of a larger collaboration around the office. You mentioned ARUP one or two or several times.
Engineers are very important.
In addition to the engineers, what's that collaborative network like and the relationships that you've developed on that? Is it a really continuous?
Yeah, I mean, people, there's one sitting there now. Robert. And they would come to us, you know, about this time.
Huh.
I think Brett was talking about other.
I mean, in addition to everyone within the office.
The people tend to come fresh. Did you come fresh from college? Yeah. And you've been in college with Bill, yeah. Bill Taylor. Then after a bit, some of them bugger off and form their own practice, like Bill and Robin. And some of them having sort of, you know, done lots of buildings with us.
But also Brett was asking about the our colleagues, engineers.
Oh.
We do. One develops a strong network. Of,
yes. To work with. They're terribly important to us. I mean architects used to involve engineers until they've done the drawings and then ask somebody to make it stand up. For us, engineering is such an integral part of what we do, and where the whole building develops out of the structure, that the. And we've worked with Arabs, I suppose, are the core of, and from out of. And then out of Arabs' office, you had two other practices forming. One was Ted Happel's practice with Michael Dixon as the younger partner. Ted went off down to Bath, I think, to run the Bath School of Architecture. Or engineering, or combined one. And Michael Dixon was the London partner, who we did all our membrane structures with. Arabs, who's my best friend in Arabs? John Thornton. And you'd have him in the office very early on, you know. John retired too young. You would tentatively and I would start off quite confidently, and he would say, "What do you want to do that for?" You know, it would develop from there, and the same as services. I mean, a lot of ideas actually are generated from some sort of servicing concept, and you think, "Oh, I can make a bit of architecture out of that," and you build it into your base thing.
Yeah. Thank you. How are those membranes coping?
Okay. Most of them are now 20 years old. You know, when membranes first appeared, they were made out of
PVC,
and that really was a hopeless material. I mean, it was okay, it was fine, it was structurally quite sound, but it was keeping the rain out and everything else, it deteriorated pretty quickly. Glass fibre grid weaves came in with... Teflon-coated glass fibre grid weave. It's the Teflon thing, that, you know, the stuff you put on saucepans. You put that on coat that on a grid weave of fiberglass. The Schlumberger building we go to once every two or three years anyway, when we're driving through Cambridge, we always sort of stop off. Huh. That must be, I don't know, 35 years old now. And it's like new. Really is like just like new, and it's never hasn't even had a hole in it, you know. Sometimes things get shot.
Other questions? Over here.
Don't worry.
No, here's one.
This side?
Oh,
yeah.
Lord.
What?
Over here.
Behind you, Mike.
Stick with it. I mean, it's an incredibly enjoyable life, isn't it, Gerald?
What are you looking forward to your practice at Hopkins Architects, or your partners?
More work. I mean, you want things to do. One's always hungry for work and fresh sort of challenge, but, you know, it's nothing nicer than coming in on a Monday morning, which doesn't happen very often, but and coming in on a Monday morning and there's a new project around. And these days, I'm not allowed to look at it. It's nicked by one of the younger partners before I get to see it.
Okay.
Patty, Michael, thank you so much for the evening and for the 40 years. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good audience.
Thank you.